biology.
Yes, hello again and welcome to this other session where today we are going to discuss about binomial nomenclature. So, what is binomial nomenclature? So, if you have been asked this question in exam, what will you say? So, you'll say that binomial nomenclature, this refers to the scientific double naming system of organism. Remember, I've said scientific and I've included double naming. So, if you only include double naming without scientific, most likely your answer will be wrong. So it is advisable to say that it is the scientific double naming system of organism. So in this scientific double naming system of organism, an organism is always given two names. So the first name given, we have the genus name. Then the second name, we have the species name. The genus name can also be called the generic name. The species name can also be called the specific name. So, in the rules, we should always know that the genus name always begins with a capital letter, while the species name always begins with a small letter. If you confuse between these two, most likely you'll get your answers wrong and it won't be pleasurable to you. So, I repeat. So, the genus name always begins with a capital letter and the species name begins with a small letter. So, what is the other rule? So, the other rule is that when writing these names, they should be underlined separately. So, you should not give them one stroke of line. No, they should be underlined separately. So, what is the other rule? So, for the other rule, these names, they should be written in italics when they are typed on a textbook or they are typed on any document. So when these names are typed or on any document, they should be written in italics. So we should know that these names, they form the basis of any scientific naming of any organisms that you have, be it plants or be it animals. Let's look at the examples of scientific names of different organisms that we have. Because remember, for the definition of biology, we defined biology as the study of life or the study of living organisms. So this means that all living organisms have scientific name within them. So for example, let's start by looking at the scientific name of human being. So the scientific name of a human being is Homo sapiens. So Homo means that it's the genus, which is Homo, then the species is sapiens. So the scientific name of human being is Homo sapiens. Let's look at the dog. What's the scientific name of the dog? Because in English, we know that this name, this organism is called a dog. But what of the scientific name? So the scientific name of a dog is Canis familiaris. So Canis is the genus name, while familiaris is the specific name. Now let's look at the scientific name of a common housefly. So the common housefly, the scientific name is Musca domestica. So this means that Musca is the genus name, while domestica is the scientific name. Now let's look at the common frog. So, what's the scientific name of the common frog? Because in English, I know that it is called a frog. But maybe a scientist in China or a scientist maybe in Jamaica or in South Africa, knowing other languages, if I say frog, they won't know that I mean this organism. So, what's the scientific name of a frog? The scientific name is Rana temporaria. So, this means that Rana is the genus name, while temporaria is the specific name. Let's look at the lion, the scientific name of the lion. Lion is English, but what of the scientific name? The scientific name of lion is Panthera leo. So if you want to mention any scientific name scientifically of the lion, you'll say Panthera leo, where Panthera is the genus name, while leo is the species name. Let's look at the other one, which is the leopard, which is a close relative to the lion. So the scientific name of leopard is Panthera pardus. So Panthera pardus. So Panthera is the genus name, while pardus is the scientific or the species name. Let's look at, let's go domestic. We look at what we use at home. The organisms at home, maybe be it food, be it poultry or whatever. So we have the chicken. So what's the scientific name of the chicken? So the chicken's scientific name is Gallus domestica. So that's the scientific name. So Gallus means the genus, domestica is the species name of the chicken. Let's look at the tomato. What's the scientific name of the tomato? So the scientific name of the tomato, it's Lycopersicon esculentum. So the scientific name of tomato is Lycopersicon esculentum. So maybe next time if you are going to the shop to buy tomatoes or anything, don't just go to the shopkeeper like someone who is not learned. Go to them like someone who's learned and ask them, please, I need to buy Lycopersicon esculentum. They'll be very happy. Even they might give you the tomatoes free of charge, because at least you'll have shown that you know and you have studied. So the Lycopersicon is the genus name for tomato, while esculentum is the scientific name or the specific name, sorry, of the tomato. Let's look at another organism which is found in the wild. We have gorilla. What's the scientific name of gorilla? So the scientific name is Gorilla gorilla. So that's the scientific name of gorilla. Pretty simple. So why should you use scientific names? Why is it important to use scientific name? Why can't we just use ordinary names to name these things? So this is the reason why scientific name is mostly used other than ordinary names. It's because scientific names, they don't change. So if this thing, we call it a dog, some other people or some other tribe or some other language group, they'll call this dog another name. So the scientific names are mostly used because they rarely do change. So also scientific names are used, the Latin language is used mostly in scientific name because Latin language rarely changes. So Latin language has been used for very many years, and since it was the pioneer language groups of the olden times, so it was adopted to name scientific names, and that's why up to date Latin name is still being used. And also lastly, so we use scientific names because it is a universal name for to name scientific organisms. So scientists can easily understand themselves. By this, I mean that scientists of maybe, for example, Kenya can be able to understand scientists of Indonesia or maybe Japan or maybe Korea. Because if I say or if I tell the scientist that I'm looking for Z maize, they'll understand that I'm looking for a maize plant. If I tell the scientist that I'm looking for Canis familiaris, they'll understand that I'm looking for a dog. Other than going to them and telling them I'm looking for a dog, yet they call a dog in their language something different. So, for today's class, we have been discussing about binomial nomenclature. So if you have any question or if there is anywhere you have not understood, feel free to ask, and also feel free to do more research. Thank you again, and let's meet on the next class as we do expound on this and more other topics. Biology.